are going to start in a few moments the first paper session, which deals with emerging work in Web 3D, new architectures, enabling applications, and implementations. We have five papers in this session, so in about 90 minutes. So I would like to ask the presenters to keep their presentations to roughly 15 minutes, and give a few minutes for questions and answers. Asios Malamos and his team is preparing the integrating WebRTC and XDOM, bridging the gap between communication and graphics. I'll let the author introduce himself and the team. Thank you.
Okay. Good morning. Okay. So, our work was to build let's say a teleconferencing infrastructure right inside a virtual world. We're using WebRTC and also we're using the Extreme platform. We believe that this effort will produce new capabilities and new potentialities to the community, not only to our community, but also to the telecommunication community. Since we aim that, and we believe, strongly believe that WebRTC, either as it is right now or in another form in the next couple of years, is going to dominate the personal communication infrastructure, let's say, applications. Okay, next. Okay. Now, we will start with a few words about WebRTC. Perhaps some of you are familiar with this platform, but anyway, we have to make some kind of introduction to this infrastructure. We have three major APIs under the WebRTC infrastructure framework. The first one is the MediaStream API, which is dedicated to exchange and present the audiovisual content. The second one is the peer connection API, which is the API that is devoted just to the sessioning and the or signaling or the control signaling of the WebRTC. And the final is the data channel, which is the channel that you can use in order to exchange data formats and data data things, not audiovisual in general. Here's a typical, let's say, WebRTC architecture. As you can see, this is the main advantage of this technique is that the media path, which is the most intensive bandwidth intensive path, it is a peer-to-peer direct connection between the two clients, the two peers. However, the signaling and all the other the signal, the control signals, and all the other the sessioning, let's say, path comes by a server that is used mostly for NAT reasons. Now, about NAT, which is network address translation. In general, when we are facing applications like chatting or real-time communication applications over the world, one of the main problems, of course, is to how we are going to translate the network address and how we are going to move the signals around in order to have this connection. Okay, here in the in WebRTC, we have three major ways in order to transmit these addresses. The STAN, which is a client server model. The TERN, which is a, let's say, also there's a server in this cycle, but there's a relay server mostly than a socket server or something. And finally, the interactive connectivity model, which is a model that, in fact, is not a model, but it is a set of tries in order to find out which is the best? I mean, if you are following the ICE model, then you know that first is going, the system is going to try and get a stamp connection right after a temp connection if everything else fails. Now, the tools we are used are somehow typical, I mean, in this case. HTML and Java, 5 and JavaScript, we consider Xtreme as part of HTML5, since we are very familiar with that. And also for the communication, Node and Socket.io, Node.js and Socket.io. Our scope was to implement, of course, a web. We did two tests, two scenarios. We implement two scenarios under this framework. The first one was to build an educational game, where a collaboration game mostly. And the second one was to, and the second one is a typical, let's say, social use of this protocol. Now, about the game. This is the more or less the architecture of the game, where we have, of course, the repository of the models. Somewhere there are XTB models. In fact, there are houses. The game, the scenario of the game is like something like the Civilization game, but more or less all we know from our youth. So the scope of the game is to use in groups of students and to build cities and to promote the cities according to their knowledge, because it is a game with the user, the player is presenting its knowledge through a system of questions and answers, and while he's presenting his knowledge, the prize is to promote his city. So we have the repository, we have the communication part, which is the WebRTC part, and so inside the communication part we have the data channel as well as the media stream part, and in the same layer we also have the manipulation of the text DOM, the manipulation of XTD, and also we have as a third part, as a system to refer, we have the down there the word, which is the XTD DOM word. All these are. Here you can see the way that the system works. I mean, the login and connection is handled by the Node.js and also the Socket.io, it is for. Now, the objective, as we said, is to make a collaborative environment. The second one. Sorry. The second application. The second application is somehow immersive application. What we mean by immersive is that the whole situation is running inside the virtual world and not in the HTML page. It is a collaborative environment as well, and the main advantage of this application is that we are using the whole infrastructure inside the virtual world. So videos, all videos from the peers, from the people that communicate to each other, are presented inside the virtual world and not in the HTML RAM. In fact, our secret scope is to prove that, as you see, if you want to use WebRTC inside the scenes, you can use it better smoother with XDB. Okay. And if you see the code, you will see that it is true. Now, the draft, schema of this application is that, we have the Node.js server as well, server pages, and it handles the request, of course, the clients are, you know, asking for request for video call. They get back through the Socket.io the response, and they connect to each other directly by peer-to-peer connection. This is the architecture of the whole system.
Okay, we have extra, let's say, facilities inside the communication.
So, as you know, with HTML5 and other frameworks, you can insert in your application and through cloud applications mostly, infrastructure mostly right now, you can embed in your in any application many of the facilities that social networks provide. But the idea is to also to have the WebRTC, Node.js signaling, WebRTC, and the XDD as the core of the whole application. I don't know if it is the right moment for some code. But anyway.
The code is just to, you know, just to explain you.
Don't you worry. The only code that is useful right now and right at this moment is that, you know, over there.
Which is the code you need in order to insert WebRTC inside the XDD world. And you can imagine how easy it can be in order to produce next generation applications, mixing up, you know, communication, telecommunication. I have some background in this, that's why I'm so interested. And also, at the same time, virtual world. The whole application and whatever is available anyway.
All the other stuff is WebRTC stuff, and that's the, you know, main problem if your background is more graphics than. But I think everybody can cover this gap because there are many help around. Okay. Now about the demo, we have enough, let's say enough bandwidth for the demo. But anyway. I'll say my conclusion and we'll see what we can do. If we don't manage to have the demo right now, I'm sure that we will manage to have the demo under Sandy's workshop where everybody can show everything that he has done. If you remember, the first demo of the application was in Canada, in Vancouver, in Sandy's workshop. But we didn't explain anything then, just show the demo, and we had the connection with Kret. You remember? Okay.
Now, what we have done is to present the WebRTC and X3DOM mix-up. We believe on this synergy. We believe that we are going to have brand new applications, very promising applications in the future. I had the opportunity to see another paper that is presented at this conference. It's a poster mostly, so you can see this poster today. And it is the collaboration part. I mean, the first part I saw, it is from a colleague in France. I don't know if she's here. Yes, she's there. She did an excellent work, and she did it with mainly with WebGL.
Yeah.
3GS, yeah. But it is the first part, I mean, the data channel exchanging part, I believe, okay? Is it true? Yes. Okay. So let's see.
Thank you, Thanasios, for showing us the code. morning coffee. If you have any questions, we have time for a few questions.
It seems that you can go real wild with this. I'm imagining video screens on a face of a cube that's spinning around in space. I mean,
can you imagine that?
Yes.
Because I'm not sure if I will be able to show you that. He's cheating because he was in Canada, I remember. But anyway, yes, I think we will show it in Sandy's workshop.
I don't have to push it more right now, but what we have to do is during Sunday's workshop is to let our laptops and the mobile phones outside this room so we can all show our demos, okay? Thank you very much for the meetings.
So, again, the title of my talk is Evaluating 3D Thumbnails for Virtual Object Galleries. And so let's directly dive into the topic. So what I mean with object gallery is something like what you see here. You have some digitized objects, and so there was some 3D scanning process, and then those objects are part of a virtual catalog, and you can browse through the catalog, you can click on some of these thumbnails, and then you will see a full screen 3D view, say using Xfreedom or 3JS or whatever you have at hand to visualize those models in 3D. And the topic of my talk today is actually this stage here where you have only these previews, so thumbnails, and you can imagine that those thumbnails could be represented in various ways. So one way is to just have images, and the other way is that you could, for example, use mouse is not responding. Shit. Okay. I'll show you the video. That's the fallback.
Would you like to use another machine?
Yeah, but there's no HDMI.
No.
Available. So that's where I was. And so another variant is to use something like jQuery Real or any other plugin to have this pseudo 3D view, which you could also entitle turntable view or image series. So you have basically a bunch of pre-rendered images, and then you can rotate the object around one axis. There are even plugins that do it with two, but then you have a really large amount of images. Mm-hmm. So that's an approach based on 2D images to realize these previews. And the question we had in mind was, can we actually do that with 3D thumbnails? So real 3D using a WebGL context and some renderer. So the question is, 2D or not 2D?
One build-up.
Or to reword it a bit more scientifically, are 3D thumbnails feasible, especially in terms of file size? Because if you think about it, a thumbnail is a preview, and the preview has to be able to load it as fast as possible, has to have a minimal size and show only the most important information, but very quickly, and then for all those models at the same time. So if the thumbnail is too large, the 3D representation, we cannot use it as a thumbnail, obviously. And I will not go into details of this thumbnail generation process. I will also show a short demo on Web3D Showcase, and we have some flyers about this pipeline which we just created, and it's available as part of our Instance 3D Hub infrastructure. I will put the flyers outside, and you can also talk to me if you're interested. So I'll not go into details. I'll just briefly explain on one slide what the process is to generate the 3D thumbnails, because it's building on established pieces. So it's nothing new in a scientific sense, and that's why I'll just explain briefly on one slide here. So first, we simplify the mesh, and you know there are plenty of algorithms to do that. And then we already have the final polygon mesh that we use for visualization. But if we would stop at this point, we obviously would have lost a lot of detail. So you can see here on this little inset that this cruciform figurine has itself a cruciform engraved on its chest. So we would lose, for example, that detail if we would just employ that very simple mesh there. So what we do is, we first generate texture coordinates, and that is done by parameterizing the mesh. Parameterization often needs a special kind of topology, like disk topology, and therefore you have to cut some seam or to segment the mesh into multiple islands. Then you parameterize each of those islands separately, and then you pack those islands into an atlas. So that's the large second step, and then you have texture coordinates. And finally then we synthesize textures. So texture images like a normal map or an albedo map for the base color, can also be occlusion map or something like that, by for each texture identifying the corresponding point on the 3D surface of the simplified mesh. And then we are doing a mesh-to-mesh ray casting from the simplified surface using the interpolated normal direction. So we walk along that normal direction in both directions, and so normal and inverse normal, and find the closest point on the 3D surface and identify that to be the corresponding point. And at that point, for the texture, we sample the normal or whatever we are interested in. So that's how we preserve the details in those normal maps and so on. And then, of course, we have to convert the result to a format that is well suited to be delivered on the web. And the result will be, for example, an Xfreedom page using Xfreedom binary containers, or SRC, whatever. And that's what we call a 3D thumbnail. So here's a result of a comparison between these 3D thumbnails and the 2D variants that I've shown you, this turntable-like image series. So I've highlighted the largest and smallest number in each of the categories, and you can see that, for example, if you compare the middle columns, 3D thumbnails are a bit larger in that case, but both are in the same range, roughly. And of course, the numbers I chose were pretty random. So, I mean, it's hard to say I compare the middle columns. So image series is more compact. It, of course, highly depends on what you want. So how many images do you want? How fluent should your interaction be? Or how many details do you want to be preserved on this 3D representation? And if you think about it, using a 200 by 200 pixels viewport, you will probably not need the 512 by 512 pixels textures for the object. So it really depends. And you can see that there are quite some differences even in the image-based variant. So this dragon mesh, it's a very slim, elongated figure and figurine, and this dragon, if you turn it at some point, if you look at it from the front side, you will see only a few pixels and the rest of the image will be white, and that's why it compresses very well. In contrast, the elephant model is large in each of the dimensions, so no matter from where you look at it, you will always have a lot of pixels that are not white, and therefore there's a lot of information, therefore the images consume more space. Similarly, on the right side for the 3 thumbnail, there are also some differences in size, and that's mainly due to the difference in simplification. So we cannot simplify each mesh to the same amount of vertices for very simple meshes, like the Christmas angel or the Nofretete bust. That would be simply too many vertices, maybe, if we choose a random number. But for others, it might be not enough. So for the B mesh, for example, which you will also see on the next slide, this is a highly complex mesh. It has been digitized by Smithsonian, and it's a B that has a lot of fine structures and a lot of layers, and this mesh needs some polygons at least in order to be represented faithfully. So here you can see it on the upper left side, and you can imagine that mesh needs a lot more polygons than the cruciform model on the bottom. Nevertheless, the interesting finding is at this point that the geometry, although it differs, so this red part here on the very bottom of the graphics, is, even for the large B mesh, not the dominant part. So your diffuse texture in JPEG and your normal texture in PNG together will always consume more space than the geometry. And even the normal texture consumes more space. And that's especially because it's stored in PNG, so we have to store it in a lossless format, since you cannot compress normal maps using JPEG, because these artifacts would, especially if you have a shiny surface, just not look good, and it's not just not feasible. So here's a visual comparison. In the paper, we have also shown how we produced it, but mainly we are rendering both with X-Freedom, so the high resolution version, and the 3D thumbnail, and then comparing pixel-wise and computing the mean square error, which you can also see visualized, modified by some factor for visualization purposes on the upper right. So what you can see here, so first of all, the approximation is relatively good, I think, as for this very simple, geometrically simple model, this Nofretete bust. On the left, you have the original scanned mesh with vertex colors, and it's almost half a million triangles, and on the right side, you have less than 1,000 triangles for the result, and it looks almost similar. And there are basically two kinds of errors that you get visually. So on the one hand, you have the geometrical error on the underlying mesh, and that can be seen on the silhouette and on the edges. So you can see that the silhouette is almost everywhere white or yellow in the difference image. And you can also see on the inset that on the left there is something missing in the crown of the figurine, but on the right that's just blurred by the geometric simplification. So it appears round here, although it's not actually round, there should be a corner missing. And errors like that can be seen around the silhouette and also here on the chin. And the other kind of errors are the errors arising from the low texture resolution. So you can already see here that this pattern is looking kind of blurry. And you can also see here that this highly detailed texture region inhibits more errors than this region, which is, has no texture detail. And now for the demonstration of the 3D variant. Mm-hmm. So these are the 3D thumbnails, and for example here the model we just saw. And as you can see, I have a full 3D interaction, so it's a small X-Freedom context, and that applies for all of these models. And I can also zoom, of course, and do all the stuff I'm used to as a 3D user. And for example, I can let it rotate here and keep talking. So as you can see, the interaction and animation is as smooth as possible in contrast to the image-based version. And I can also have different rendering effects. So I could say, okay, I want to use a plain white albedo here instead of the albedo map, or I want to visualize the normal map directly in order to see only the surface details. And then I can also go back to the original version. Let's come to the conclusion. Comparing both variants, you can identify several advantages, disadvantages. And let's start with the 2D image series. So basically, if you think about it, if you create images, you can use any degree of realism. You can also take photos of a real object. Of course, that depends on your application. So if you're going to visualize something with WebGL later on, the preview should maybe have the same quality and not be a photo, otherwise people will be disappointed. But basically you can use any degree of realism. They are also very straightforward to generate, so rotating around an object in a script and producing images is not that complicated, and it's a very generic approach. They are independent from the geometric complexity, so especially the file size is rather independent from the geometric complexity. And especially when you have a small number of images, so say 8 for example, you don't get the smoothest interaction, but you have definitely the more compact solution compared to the 3D thumbnail. So the 3D thumbnail offers a lot more possibilities for interaction, obviously, as you've just seen, and then also more possibilities for rendering. and we have not tried a lot of things. So you could also think about things like moving the light source with your mouse or a lot of different stuff. And they are also very compact, the 3D thumbnails, if the shape is rather simple, like it's not rotating fast. And obviously they are the best solution if you require smooth interaction. So my last slide to wrap up of the talk, we have presented a pipeline for 3D thumbnail creation, and we have compared 3D thumbnails and 2D image series to realize a turntable-like rotation, and we have made a comparison mainly in terms of file size. And our conclusion is that if you have a good generation algorithm, 3D thumbnails can be as compact as images, and of course both methods, 2D1 and 3D1, have their specific advantages and disadvantages. And we have just evaluated now the technical feasibility of 3D thumbnails. So obviously you can do a lot more. The question is, does it always make sense to have more interaction possibilities? So that's a usability question, and that's a completely different topic. So thanks a lot for your attention, and I'm open to questions.
Thank you, Matt. Do you have any questions for Max?
Hi there. Very interesting talk, thanks very much. I have two questions. The first comes from a previous life where I worked in a company doing solutions of virtual fashion. And we had this idea of presenting, you know, 3D representations of clothing, garments. And we were competing against the industry where it's very established, like taking 360-degree images of a pair of jeans or something and putting that online is now a very established thing. It's a very established workflow. You send your jeans away, they get photos get taken, you get the photos back, and it works very well. And so I was pleased the last two points you put there, because you're comparing your 2D and 3D, and yet you mentioned you don't discuss the usability. And my experience is that in the real world, when there's a real photo available, people are always going to prefer the real photo to the 3D representation, no matter how good that rendering is. And the second point, it's more of a question really. You're comparing 2D versus 3D in this paper, but you don't really compare, I know it's part of your previous work, but the mesh simplification work you've done. So I don't really understand, like, why can't I just take Maya on my laptop, simplify my meshes with some very advanced industry grade mesh simplification algorithms, and dump them straight into the context there that you've got. I don't really understand what you don't compare the simplification of your technique versus the simplification I could run on Maya or 3D Studio Max right here. And I'd be interested to see some comparisons about that.
Okay, so first of all, I would need to say that our tool is a professional tool. So it's part of the Instance 3D Hub architecture, and this is being sold to customers for a long time now. And I think it's the simplification algorithm itself is not that important. And I think by employing this standard methods from the OpenMesh library in that case, we are already pretty good in obtaining a simplified mesh. The more crucial part for the quality of the result is what comes afterwards. So like how you segment the mesh, for example, here, and how you parameterize that. So with the bad parameterization, you would have a lot of stretch and a lot of wasted texture space, similar to the packing algorithm, how you pack those islands into the texture. So I would say simplification, we are already pretty good, and Maya and others are comparable. What we need to tweak to be the best thumbnail generation tool in the world is the packing algorithm. Oh, sorry. So the packing algorithm of packing islands into the texture, which is here only bounding box based, but it could be even better, and the segmentation, which is an open topic. So usually for games and stuff, people do not segment automatically, which is our approach. So our aim is to do everything automatically. You throw in, say, 200 meshes that you have scanned, you wait some while, and then you get 200 X Freedom pages. And that should be fully automatic. And usually in the industry, for example, when doing games, an artist can do segmentation at edges where it makes sense, and then you get a really good result. But that, especially that step, segmenting the mesh ideally for parameterization, is has not been automated in a very smart way, and that's what we're working on right now.
Thanks. Great. Thank you, Max.
Last night we learned a little bit about Greek history. Does anybody know the story of Socrates? Oh, good. Socrates was a wise man. He talked a lot. They killed him. Okay, so I will take that lesson to heart today, and we have about 27 seconds per slide, but really, and these are all leave behind, so far too much detail, but I have great confidence in your visual bandwidth, so. This work is approximately 25 years in the making. We're very excited about it. It builds directly on the things that Thanos was talking about. And we were able to integrate the OpenDIS code base and the X3DOM code base and show implementations of the X3D entity state PDU and all sorts of other good things that can take us to the promise that many people have been working to for a long time of network virtual environments that are just scalable, growable, ad hoc, not controlled by anyone else. So here we go. So most of you are quite familiar with these standards and these techniques. It's interesting that even in the subset of X3DOM, HTML5, and scripting, there are some distinct differences in classical ways and new ways and terminology. So it's quite a maze to be navigated. And we've tried wherever possible to stick to standards approach so that this could be fully scalable to the web. Here's a little background on the IEEE Distributed Interactive Simulation Protocol. It's a packet format that works to describe lots of information. There's, I think, something like 87 different packet types. We've implemented about 8 within this implementation. And within X3D, there are many, many more that are possible. They're widely used by a lot of folks in the military worldwide. They're also used by some civilian applications. I think they're notable in that they're very physics-based, very reality-based, and not gamer-based on who's shooting who and other specialty things. So here's a little bit more about it. It is considered a heavyweight protocol in that the packets are fairly large. It was designed in the early 90s. But because the semantics are so clearly defined and so broadly implemented, perhaps in thousands of systems, that's what made it appealing to us. So I want to emphasize here that we're not creating something out of nothing, but we're attempting to do another implementation of the already standardized X3D DIS nodes. And we have some of them listed there. A particular note that we think is critical is the real-time discovery of new entities. If things just appear on the network, how do you know who they are? How do you pop up the right model? X3D provides mechanisms for that already. Thanks to our lead-off presenter for talking about WebSockets and WebRTC. Don McGregor is the lead programmer on all this stuff. He built it out in the OpenDIS library, and he's able to use both of these. WebSockets is point-to-point, client-to-server, and has pretty excellent support. It's fully defined. We've got links in there. Here's what the topology looks like for these things. Again, correct client, server. But the server can mediate sharing of state, sharing of packets between all the participants. So X3D exposes that functionality. You can send or receive or simply be a standalone passive listener if you're testing. Okay, we've done extensive testing of the protocols and all the different parts. Here's a great website called Can I Use that tells you about browser support for a wide variety of protocols, languages, et cetera, so we can see at a glance here that adoption is pretty good for web sockets. The links there changes perhaps on a daily basis. WebRTC is also fairly mature. It's been around for a couple of years. There are some books out on it now too, early adoption books, but the protocols are not quite locked down yet. However, if you click on that RFC standards link, you'll find that there are several dozen related protocols put together, at least, or I shouldn't say several dozen, but 10, 15, something like that. So if you're familiar with the basics of sockets, connection-oriented would be web sockets. UDP, connectionless, quote-unquote non-reliable, best effort delivery would be what WebRTC is good for. And it looks sort of client-servery at some points and then peer-to-peer at others, because it can set up intermediate servers in your browser talking to each other, so very clever. We have Mark Pullen in the audience. He's been coming to these things for a long time. I asked Mark a question. I don't know if you remember this one, Mark. Years and years ago, said, gee, as we, you know, we're not going to get multicast through the browsers and the firewalls and everything else, but this server-side stuff's getting faster and faster. What are we going to call it when we use that for peer-to-peer? What's that networking protocol going to be? And do you recall your reply? You told me, well, I don't know about you, but I'm going to call it multicast. So here we go. We're seeing, in effect, the same behaviors of scalable networking, but compatible with the current architecture and security stance of the web. Some more quick pictures. You can see the arrows are indicating you don't have to push everything through the server here, but you can leapfrog client to client. And not bad performance. And it's also cool that a lot of these things are tracking on mobile. In fact, in our preparations here, we got it working on Android phone, and we're debugging Apple, because that worked. iPhone worked on an earlier incantation. New stuff. Or everything old is new again. It's hard to get the right coordinate system sometimes, but X3D has been very formal and rigorous about it. Our work on this project revealed that when the DIS nodes were established in X3D, we overlooked that geospatial nature, and that does need to be formalized. We have some good future work here. How do we make those nodes perfectly geospatial? DIS, by the rules, is a geocentric center of the Earth coordinate system. So building tools, converters, bridges, those are the types of work that you see accumulating on the open disk site. It also deals a lot with modeling. If you want to import somebody else's model into your scene, it matters a lot which way it points, or else you'll import somebody's beautiful model and start driving it around exactly backwards or upside down. So we've been listing our conventions in here and continue building it up. I should have probably put some more exclamation points on this. We were expecting performance in the hundreds of packets per second, and we're getting performance for over a year now of thousands. And we've seen browser network performance increase by perhaps a factor of 100 in the last couple of years. They've all been optimized for JavaScript and intensely faster. This is far more state than I think almost anybody in this room is able to take advantage of. So we're erasing a long-held ceiling, and it'll be really interesting to see where people go. Okay, we have a bunch of demos, or a handful of demos, I should say. We have some screenshots here. This has worked not just with X3DOM, but we built it up with some basic text in HTML. This one shows DIS packets getting generated inside of KML, And we were driving this feed with a automatic identification system, which is a merchant ship and other ships at sea. Every minute or so will broadcast their position and where they're going. And so this highlights some of the liveness of that. And then we just started drawing it. To get it all to work, we started with a flat earth, and then we clamped all of the entities to sea level. And we're pulling libraries out of our Savage Model Library, which does observe those extensions. We've put up a new server called TRACK, T-R-A-C-K, at MPS, which we've made publicly available. It has an open source Java server called Jetty. Don picked that because we're a Java shop. We can do some of this stuff with Apache too, but we're looking at portability of servers and how can we share those with others. No shortage of implementation issues. I want to give, if Don McGregor did most of the plumbing and connection, the implementation work here was done by one of our students, Byron Harder, who did a fabulous job of putting some of these things together. And here's where you can get code. We think the code is just about ready for a push to X3DOM, but it might be premature. We might want to finish up some of that geospatial stuff first. Look forward to people's opinions on that. The nice thing about, yet another nice thing about X3DOM is you can put experimental nodes first and still take advantage of the whole code base compatibly. So it's a great development environment. That's where we're at. We still have a to-do list. We're grateful to the conference for letting us show this. We put a video online that shows the demo. Here's a couple of screenshots from that. Things zooming at each other, going by, et cetera, et cetera. Plenty of work left to do. But our conclusions are we're poised to break out and make this widely available. And we welcome others who might want to continue. So should I put the video up while we do questions, or should we just?
Yeah, that's fine. We can put the
okay.
video up. We
have what did you receive?
Time for one question. Or not?
Please.
Oh, great. Thanks. It's great to see this evolving. Could you help maybe explain a little bit about the kinds of things that you mentioned DIS as heavyweight? If I was thinking about it to use it in a game situation, what would be some of the downsides I might look out for or to mitigate? I mean, why is it heavyweight, or what does that give you in terms of application mm-hmm. capability?
Well, heavyweight, I think it's 1200 bytes is a typical packet size. It depends on the message. It's also a very big family of protocols, but there's a lot of legacy systems that use it. When you go into the game domain, you find that almost everybody is rolling their own protocol. They're very tuned and they're very difficult to break into. I mean, they're trying to avoid cheating. We've had a proposal that has risen and fallen over the years of a network sensor, how to generalize that. I think that could come back, because we certainly are open to that kind of thing, but we want to unlock all these other sims and get them on the web, because that's part of our university domain that I'm interested in. Happy to follow up on.
Thank you, Don.
Organization that helped support this research, the Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute. So this is just a report of the details of implementing the specification in X3DOM for the very important geospatial component nodes that we needed to support the work that we do at MRI. A bit of background first. The geospatial component began over 15 years ago. Martin Reddy published a paper in 2000, describing geothermal back before X3D. And then the evolution of that, we had the evolution of X3D being a modular framework for that, and geospatial became a component of that. And in 2009, Johannes Baer published X3DOM paper, and we chose X3DOM just to implement these nodes in because of it already had some geospatial support. And it was open, we're able to contribute to it, and extensible and basic user-friendly nature. So motivation for doing implementing geospatial in X3D is that it provides a unique niche between typical GIS frameworks, which are mainly 2D, derived from a mapped-based view of presenting geospatial information, and connecting it with the 3D graphics world. And there's some advantages that it's inherently 3D. X3D is inherently 3D in the computer representation of the data. And in the construction that Martin Reddy designed in the original GeoVermal, there's an abstract support for different spatial reference systems. So it's very extensible to handle all kinds of ellipsoids and datums and geoids. Just a few of those have been implemented in the X3D. And there's many application areas for this. It's geological or geophysical data, a lot of subsurface earth data visualization. In my field, oceanographic or atmospheric data, where you could have volumetric data, and there's the need for interactivity in those kinds of data presentations. So you might ask, well, why, how does X3D geospatial relate to virtual globes? The common things that we use all the time, like Google Earth or Cesium, WorldWind, there's others. And it seems that X3D geospatial offers similar functionality, but it's really much more generalized in X3D. As I mentioned before, in the domains of geophysical data, we can represent subsurface information. In a tool like Google Earth, you cannot put like an earthquake fault, or I cannot put data underneath a submarine volcanic vent. There's no way to represent that data in KML in Google Earth. And because X3D geospatial is generalized, we actually could build a digital globe, given enough data and performance and servers. We could build a Google Earth competitor based on X3D geospatial. And the other advantage for X3D geospatial is we get for free all of the other features of X3D. We get the other communities of CAD and interactivity and all of the great things that we can do in X3D. So a little background on coordinate systems we talk about. Don had a good slide in his last presentation about the geospatial coordinate system. We have latitude, longitude here in this image represented by some Greek letters. And there's a Cartesian coordinate system, X, Y, Z, you can see here at the origin, and that's a geocentric coordinate system. So the native coordinates in X3D geospatial are geocentric, and that's what's passed eventually to the rendering pipeline. But the way we get data from our GPS devices are latitude, longitude. So there needs to be conversion between these coordinate systems. And there's a third coordinate system, and that's the native 3D computer graphics coordinate system. In X3D, the way that's oriented, X is to the right on the screen, Y is up, and Z comes out of the screen towards you. So this, just flipping back to the other one, this is quite different than the geocentric. So you think, well, I can just use Cartesian coordinates for Earth data and X3D data, but they don't work. Quite well. So in the nature of the X3D coordinate system, it's Cartesian, it's abstract. There's no sense of units or location in that. Although we do have the concept of canonical units of meters. That's typical. So the XZ plane is horizontal and plus Y is up. So what the geospatial component does, it handles all the transformations and precision calculations needed to convert between these coordinate systems. And that makes it easy. You can specify your coordinates using WGS84 ellipsoid. And if you use the geo nodes, it rotates things properly so that Y is up and you can use it. A walk navigation mode for your geospatial data. And that is the goal of the geospatial working group, in fact, is to make it easy to use geospatial data in X3D. So going into some details, these are outlined more detail in the paper about specifically how these were implemented. To simplify things a bit, taking the 3D Earth, put a slice through it, and this shows how the geo origin node is implemented. And the reason why we have geo origin is is if you measure the distance of the Earth, at the distance of the center of the Earth from the surface of the Earth from the center of the Earth, you get big numbers. And those numbers are often too big for a single precision floating point pipeline. So the geo-origin subtracts a point from all those coordinates so that we get smaller numbers and the data can flow through a rendering pipeline without any precision artifacts developing. Because you can get camera jitter, you can get object placement problems if you're feeding numbers that are too big, 100 million kind of numbers, more than 7 or 8 digits of precision, you'll get round-off precision problems. So if you have really high precision use case, data that you want to render with centimeter scale precision and have centimeter scale resolution for your camera placement, you do need a geo-origin. And a peculiar aspect of geo-origin is every geonode has to have a child geo-origin, which is easy to do with a def use syntax in X3D. And these are some more details about how one of the features that is added in the geo-origin is a rotate Y up field. And this would be something that you would want to do if you want to support fly or walk or helicopter navigation mode in your scene, because you want to have the X3D Y vector up in your world. And this does that for you. Again, all the details for the matrix transformations are in the paper and in the source code. Geolocation is a very handy node. If you've got a CAD model or a model of a building and arbitrary coordinates, you can place that model on the globe. And what the geolocation node does is it takes the origin of that model and puts it at the location that you specify, latitude, longitude, elevation, coordinates, and then rotates the child's plus y vector up, the local y up in the X3D coordinate system, and the child's minus z direction towards the local north pole. And here's a pictorial representation of how that's done. An example of a geolocation, and there's a peculiar sort of thing that we have to take care of if you specify a geo origin. There's some complication if you also specify rotate Y up, because that's the same sort of calculation that's being done. And in doing our experiments and making sure that these scenes worked in the basic archive that's available in the X3D project, we cannot skip both rotations. The geolocation rotation about child origin must be done, the geolocation translation, and the geo origin back translation rotate Y up position. All the details in the paper if you care. Geo viewpoints are a very useful node. You can specify a viewpoint using geospatial coordinates, and it'll orient the local up direction properly so that the navigation looks right. In addition, there's an elevation scaling parameter. If you want to visualize data from space, say space to face, you want to fly into the Earth, you need to actually slow down the speed as you get closer to the surface of the Earth so you don't zoom right through the center of the Earth. So when you're out in space at a satellite elevation, you want to move fast, down close to the surface, you need to slow. So the elevation scaling automatically adjusts the navigation speed based on elevation above the geoid, above the ellipsoid. And it's only used in fly-like modes, not in examine-like modes. It does have a lower limit of 1. We found that if you set it, originally it was set to 0, and you could never go through the 0 elevation, which is what I want to do, dive underneath the surface of the ocean. So it has a limit of 1. Geoposition interpolator is a way to create tracks and animations in space. And if you've got a large distance that you want to rotate through, then we actually have an attribute that's not in the specification but added in the X3DOM implementation on great circle, which will do a great circle slurp algorithm for those large distances. So this is something that you can put in a scene and route some events through and create moving tracks in your world. We did have some time to work on some experimental notes, and there's been some talk about the proto facility that's in X3D, but X3DOM does not support X3D proto. But we found it was pretty straightforward to implement new nodes just in straight directly in JavaScript. Examining how that was done in X3DOM, follow existing coding patterns, and because it's an open source project, we can include those and include them off our own web servers. So there's a couple of experimental nodes. One, the GeoOrigin Transform, which I've used in some of our bathymetry data, which is we create meshes in geocentric coordinates, but we need to apply a GeoOrigin to that. So this is a node that helps subtract that GeoOrigin and do the proper rotate height calculation for high precision uses. And we've also discovered with some further experimentation that it might be simpler to replace this GeoOrigin transform, because it's kind of a difficult concept to understand. And there's a GeoTransform node that is in the spec, and it may be simpler to add a new directive to that node and have it perform the same transformations that we originally tested in the GeoOrigin transform. And another really pretty exciting avenue to explore is this GeoWebMap, which connects what we call Slippy maps. These are standard 2D open web map technologies, things like OpenLayers. There's a lot of them out there. Google Maps is one. There's OpenStreetMaps is the data behind a lot of these free 2D mapping servers. And it's nice about these is that you can access open information of people that have already created massive terrain tile sets of the globe. OpenStreetMaps, a good one. Esri makes a nice map of the seafloor base that we use. And because it is HTML5, we have some experiments, mostly this is Andreas's work, two-way mapping between an open layers 3 map on the top, and then on the bottom is an X3DOM div on the web page. And if you pan the 2D map, the 3D scene automatically updates. We did have to add a little bit of JavaScript to do the automatic update from X3DOM back to the open layers div. And it works both ways. So we can actually spin the globe and zoom out, and then the open layers also works. So this is a way to bring in other data into the X3DOM space in a completely HTML5 browser independent fashion. So I think this is pretty exciting. The code that does this actually generates dynamically an elevation grid. Currently it's just a flat grid, but we'd like to really integrate that with terrain data as well. So it's possible to build really rich applications with X3DOM geospatial building blocks. The paper describes briefly a couple targeted applications. One is my institution, the Spatial Temporal Oceanographic Query System, and then Andreas's work with the community fault model for Southern California. And there's some screen grabs here. There's a YouTube video, probably can't watch it here with our network. If you search for Stokes robot data, you'll find a 3-minute YouTube that describes that application. And then the community fault model. So in summary, important X3DOM nodes have been implemented for dealing with geospatial data. It enables a large class of targeted applications. It conforms to the ISO specification. Through our experimentation, the GeoOrigin node, though deprecated in the 3.3 spec, version spec, we find it is still desirable. And it's all available in the current release of X3DOM.
Thank you, Mike. We're going to delay questions for Mike for during the coffee break, because we have only a few minutes left, 12 minutes left. Thank you again. Okay. Our next presenter is Nicholas, and of course he's the last presentation, and he's the one that promised to do the presentation in less than 5 minutes. <I'm just kidding. laughs> So we still have about 13 minutes left. Questions for the last two presenters during the coffee break. So,
I
Nicolas is going to present a facility, an open framework for cross-platform mirror work installations.
I think we can use some minutes from the commentary.
We will use some minutes, of course, but I don't want to use too many, so let's try to keep it on schedule. Within 5 minutes, maybe 10.
All right, thank you. It's a pleasure to present and share with you some of the work that we're doing at Virginia Tech. And this is a great session because a lot of the efforts that are going on, the geospatial and the network communication, all kind of fit into this. And so they're really relevant for us, and I look forward to working with my colleagues here on these problems. I'm part of a team from Virginia Tech. I've in italics here are our undergraduates, part of the team, and my co-authors, who have put together a system for basically online art exhibitions, as it were. And I'm going to hit the space bar. There we go. So this is our Center for the Arts. This is a brand new building on Virginia Tech campus. It's $93 million. It's amazing performance hall, gallery spaces, student workshops, 3D printing lab, all sorts of great things. And we have basically taken a digitized that model. The Center for the Arts is also known as ICAT. You can follow some things here to find out more about it, but the idea that we came at this was that the building is the instrument. It's the instrument that is sensing the people that are going through it, so it's an instrument that we can study crowd behaviors, but it's also an instrument that we can express, for example, have media shows and audio and video installations. And so realizing this, we wanted to build something that could provide a platform for artists and faculty to quickly build installations, multimedia galleries, and have those be accessible locally and on the web. So I'm going to talk about that a little bit. This is part of an NSF-funded project on Mirror Worlds. Several years ago, we posed Mirror Worlds, the definition, in a Web3D paper. Which is basically that there's spatial and temporal correspondence between two things. So you have a place that looks like my house, and if something happens in my house, it's reflected into the mirror worlds, and I can see it. There's also a very advanced research facility called the Create Cube, and we're using a lot of this technology in that facility. The Verge did a feature on the cube just recently. So we've talked a lot about, hearing a lot, especially yesterday, about the mixed and augmented reality and Milgram's continuum. And so I thought I would just include that here as a reference for us all. But what we're looking at for the ICAT world and the capabilities is actually all of these things. So this dimension of Milgram doesn't really help us structure the design space very much. Instead, we are thinking about how these events are shared, so the event aspect of the mirror worlds, rather than maybe Milgram's focus is much more on the displays and how those are composited to a viewer. But in this building, I'm showing you our lobby area. We have several overhead cameras that are tracking traffic, as well as different kinds of displays in and around the space. And we kind of decided that maybe one of the things that we should look at as another dimension of reality or virtuality or is really how does the events flow? Who's generating them, who's producing them, and who's consuming them? And so this little taxonomy has been helpful for us and our students to kind of organize who needs to connect and how to the mirror world. So it's a great collaboration. We have several faculty from our School of Visual Arts,
working with us. You know, they have students who are working in Maya and all kinds of different sorts of art tools, content creation tools. And but we also want to, you know, we realize that the web is bigger, and we would like to be able to have people access the mirror world through through HTML5. So that's one of our goals. And the other goal is that this should be something that we can get content into, so that we can have visiting artists and so on put up installations. So we built something very similar to things you've seen today, although what we did was we sort of started from scratch in the sense of what's the messaging protocol. This was a great learning experience for us and our students, but we leveraged Node.js and Socket.io and built basically a multi-user server in a semester, and set it up so that you could have several channels. Right, so I might have an installation by one artist for the room, but later that afternoon another faculty wants to use that, so the sensors in that room can also be fed into other channels. So this is an idea that's sort of a subscribing to the events of a mirror world. And it's pretty simple, really, JSON encoding of messages, so it's rather naive at the moment, but it's flexible enough that we want to be able to push UI events and other kinds of gestures, or, for example, skeleton positions from a Kinect or something. And then a way to basically build new mirror worlds easily through a web interface for our faculty to say, okay, I'd like to launch one for my class tomorrow. It should be just a button to be able to push and set that up. So quickly, these are schematics that you probably have seen before, but it gives you an idea of the different kinds of data that we're moving around. Sound is something we're very interested in, but it's still not not on the front burner for us, so to speak, but certainly is coming. And the Fusality server is basically just the piece that provides the synchronization and passing entity data. Okay. So we built this for our gallery opening, and I'll show you a few pictures here. But the idea is that the server is just part of the network layer, and we should have many different clients be able to connect to that. So we have discussed in the paper and here in the demonstration, basically, you know, a version of the world that is running in Unity, and I connect to the mirror world, and there I can see anyone else who's connected through HTML5. So it's the same mirror world delivered to different clients, and because we're using the web as the abstraction layer and the network communication, this is possible. So I just kind of point out a few elements of the system. There's an overhead camera here that's looking down. It's tracking all the users in the space, which are being reflected into the mirror world here, in this case projected on the wall, and they're kind of like blue floating clouds, is the representation for the people. That was interesting. You'll see on the left, we also tried some creepy humanoids, and it was sort of clear that there's something very much like the Uncanny Valley going on here in with characters, for sure. It's sort of better to see someone as a cloud than someone that's sort of not looking quite right. But also in the mirror world, you know, if somebody has moved a bench or a trash can or something from the model, that can actually cause some really interesting situations. There's another picture of the opening. What we did, we had a group of students who has been working mostly in MATLAB to do different kinds of sensor systems. The one is dealing with the vision tracking from the overhead cameras. Also, we have done some audio triangulation. So with a set of microphones, we can figure out which blob issued the voice command in the room. Delivered live worlds to Unity and X-Freedom. So we think that's kind of exciting. We sort of have our cake and eat it too. But there's a lot of work things that are still laid out before us, things that we need to do for scientific reasons, but also for the artistic reasons. Certainly managing, you know, event logging, being able to do playback at different levels of fidelity. These are live worlds. There's going to be students, there's going to be teachers, there's going to be people who are allowed to do certain kinds of events and activities and some that aren't. So we need to have some way to manage roles and distributed events. Really excited to see the work on WebRTC and DIS. This is something certainly we're going to look at in the near term this summer and coming year. In the Cube, we've also been dealing with some issues about the size of the different models. So in a few of our applications, and you'll see in the Cube, if you follow that Verge video, basically Oculus Rift and tablets walking around in a large tracked space, each seeing their own view of something virtual, but that virtual thing has to be rendered on the tablet, right? So what we were starting to do is we've got a little cluster of NVIDIA Grid cards and have figured out now how to basically just do server-side rendering in these cases of large models and just ship pixels to the client. This is opens up a lot of areas for research, and because we have an interdisciplinary group, I think we're going to see a lot of production in these different areas. What is the effect of fidelity, as we talked about, the avatar representation on presence? There's the engineering side of ubiquitous computing, where we're just trying to deal with sensor scale and form factor even. Scalability, Don mentioned 5,000 updates a second. That's really amazing. And I think when we see, we get a very popular exhibit, we also need to prepare for, hundreds of users in this mirror world. There's a few infrared cameras actually in the performance hall. So if you're listening to a show, we can sort of, this is all with IRB approval, of course, and your consent. But we can basically gather affect or emotional data from performances. We can look at how traffic patterns go on an exhibit day or after classes. And also making games like this where, we have to cooperatively work on to a solution. I think this is something that we've started just with trivia games at this point, but it's something similar, I think, to what you're working on. That would be a good connection. So fusality, the fusing of real and virtual worlds, basically coming at it from the web point of view and the open platforms point of view. So we look forward to developing it further and leveraging all the great work that you guys are doing. So thank you.
Thank you.
Great work. If you have any questions for Nicholas, we still have 1 minute, basically, or half an hour. It's up to you. We can take the coffee break here.
Thank you. I was just interested to know, like, is that application can also be used like for security purposes? Like you said, you had a tracking camera which can take the pictures of some people in the hall, and
yes,
probably can be linked to some other application which can analyze the people who are in the, if there's someone who is wanted maybe in that particular scene.
That's a great question. Yeah, it's definitely something that we have to, especially in a public space, In our case, we're explicitly letting people know that they're, you know, on camera. But we're not recording any of the video, so that's something that's also important from a privacy point of view. You can't locate a person, an individual who walked through an installation. That's actually something that would be a FERPA sort of challenge. You don't want to keep identifying data around or let it be streamed over an unsecured link. Right, so there are lots of security cameras on Virginia Tech, believe me. but these ones are, we don't keep any of the video data, and it's sort of intentional that we will keep the blob tracks, maybe. And in certain cases, in a mirror world where it's a classroom, you know, so we have a set of students. In the virtual side, we do have a correspondence between an entity and a name. So we know that, you know, my student Hannah did X, Y, and Z on Tuesday. So there is some logging, but the raw video is not logged.
Thank you. Thank you, Nicholas. In a minute, in this session, we have three full papers and two short papers. The session focuses on application in industry and manufacturing. Our first speaker is Johannes Baer. He will talk about web-based instance 3D hub, visual computing as a service, infrastructure to deliver adaptive, secure, and scalable user-centric data visualization. Thank you.
Long title and a long list of courses. The reason why I just mentioned joint paper between Farmers IGT and EF, and I just would like to mention the people that are actually in the room. So it's Max Linder, Herr Franke, me, and Christoph Contor, and Samuel Perform. EF back there, so if you would like to discuss some of these topics, go ahead. So I only have 15 minutes, so I had to take us 2-3 slides and go over them faster, so I hope this still is useful at the end. So we are from the Fraunhofer IGT Institute in Darmstadt, which is about, in some 250 researcher, and in Darmstadt itself, a different department, and one department that really works on visual computing system technology. And this group or department really is well known for establishing different systems and platforms over the years. So if we look at the timeline, that we started in the 90s already to really work on virtual augmented reality systems, where we found a spin-off. And then some of you might know OpenSG, where it's really about scene craft and distributed rendering, and then moved 2005 to virtual augmented reality platforms, where we use X3D as application programming layer. And the main goal was to ease the application development process by using a standard. And with moving with this augmented reality application to smaller and smaller devices, we looked at that technology again, and that's the reason why we introduced a new model to integrate X3D into HTML. And there, one of the main problems with industrial application was really that we had to deal with these large data sets, and encoding everything in XML was not useful and helpful. So we were working on specific mesh encoder. And there we already combined this client-side technology with on-the-fly transcoding services. So we already attached this basic client technology to server-side processing. And now you can see the pattern. It's almost every 5 years. It's really that we rethink this whole infrastructure. If we can better integrate the different component to really lead to a better overall system. So that's what we understand with visualization as a service platform. So the overall system really must be much more adaptive to visualize any 3D data on any platform. So not just web, but Java or native platform. And what we would like to tackle that with this current systems, also with X3D or whatever you take, massive data usually leads to large startup time and low frame rate. Frame rates, and the problem is that the refresh ratio, responsiveness, and quality control really needs to be optimized by a single needs to be controlled by a single optimizer. So this refresh ratio and the quality is are really contracting elements here, and we need something that allows us to really to model the user intention. So this massive and complex data, simple devices, minimal instant graph, so not a complex scene graph, but just a simple instant graph that allows you to describe the relation between your data as application API. And then what you also need is some form of totally automatic service orchestration. So not the user has to control the different services like until now, but this has to be automatic. And what we also would like to have is something that can do visualization, image generation on different occasions in the pipeline, so client server, hyperparameter. And the main problem really is, the core problem is the scalability problem, that we cannot, that until now the most systems really were built for massive data, but then with some restrictions on how many changes you could apply to parts of the system during runtime. So a lot of the basic large model visualization systems really work on static data. So combining this dynamic aspect, this complex data, is really something that's the core question for us. So the scene crowds are extremely good at dynamic data, but they really have problems with large and complex data sets. So systems that can work with complex data sets, like out-of-core systems, cannot really deal with that tools. So we need, at the end, a couple of essential building blocks, and that's what we worked on over the year, without mentioning all the different papers, but the most important things are these three aspects from the system point of view. So we need something that allows us to compress mesh and texture data really compact, but on the other hand, so it's a really a balanced encoding that can present really compact, but on the other hand, really has almost no decompression efforts. That we can do progressive streaming and to really deal with online and offline patching of this data, and that we can do a fast spatial indexing or re-indexing on our data, so on server client side. So that are really the building blocks that we need to build this new infrastructure. So what we are talking in, what do we understand by application? So our applications are everything that runs inside, for example, a web application and deals with this large data set. But for example, this EDF data up there, where's this hundreds of thousands of objects that really need to be managed, but also quality of the rendering is an aspect, but also mobile devices. So all these different things is what we need to talk about. And the basic idea is that we really abstract the whole pipeline in a single service infrastructure. That we just say, okay, the user defines what pixels he wants with what qualities in the client, but doesn't say anything about formats or anything, and defines what the original data is and the relation between the data. And the visualization and the service infrastructure does all the pieces in between. So that's really the pieces of the infrastructure where different front-side rendering systems and update systems talk with transcoding and visualization pieces that do server-side rendering and server-side culling and other things. But the most important part is that upfront on the left side, there's really this simple instant graph API, which allows you faster.
If you point with the mouse, you
okay.
Can see.
Sorry. There, highlighted instant graph API that allows you to link your original data and make setups, graph setups that then are mapped to different systems. So what we have in the client is this unified structure, this instant graph, which holds the struct tree and a couple of other aspects, but also spatial relationships and then different views and controller, and that this can be 2D views or just 3D renderings, but also UI elements and trees, but also search elements. So they allow you to search in this data representation, but also DOM APIs. So the DOM is not the first class API anymore, but it's just one of many. Because the DOM itself really has performance issues, stuff that we always stated that we can just put a certain number of objects there and cannot deal with hundreds of thousands of objects. So we have to keep smaller, more compact representation. Good. And this really links original data with this container, with this Link3D data container, which transcode the original spatial the original structure description to some open linked data structure. So we use the original documents and original elements that have the limitations that you have to download the full document before you can really understand what's in the document. So X3D and XML and whatever 3D format you use, Collada, they're not made for streaming. So you have to download the full package until you can really analyze and understand what they are. So you cannot request the system, give me all shapes that are in a specific spatial volume or in a view frustum. So that's a real limitation. So you first have to download and then can start. So what we need is some open structure that we can already traverse on another part of the system. So what we do is we translate the information, all the shapes and instances and everything, to an open structure that then can be traversed by client or server with systems. So that looks scary, but it has a different role. So it's not that it's something the user cares about, because the user doesn't know about the caching infrastructures. So if you look at how this pipeline usually work, is that you have some domain data that goes to 3D, then 3D to your visualization system, wherever it is in your client or in your server, and the visualization system then produces pixels. And if you use an X3D pipeline, to two times transport the same container. So going from the domain to the visualization and then visualization to pixels, the same thing. Our infrastructure, there's no explicit representation that you care about, what the user or application developer cares about. It's just cache entries that get transferred between the system. So on the very beginning, you give the links or the URIs of the original data and how it's accessed, the identification information and everything, and then this is used as identifier in the whole system. And then this Link3D data is built in different cache entries and then transported. So you can still put X3D in there and it will visualize the X3D data, but really on the very beginning. You just say to the system, okay, visualize this X3D data, but then it goes and translates it on the fly to something else. So on the top, you really see it's very, very nice thing about X3D, it's so simple. Everybody can understand it, everybody can implement it, and you use really the same idea of object at every layer. So you transport it, the X3D SynCraft API is exactly the same, and then you use the rendering system. Which X3D, it's almost the same, you just limit it to what X3D representation, there's no verbal representation, and then you use the DOM instead of the SRI. But it's still X3D, so you don't have to rethink anything. With the new infrastructure, we really, since we are focused on how the imagery is really then delivered to the user, we find better solutions in the parts in the middle. But since this is totally automated, the user and developer doesn't know anything about it, it's still a valid choice. And then what's really different on the visualization part, we really render on client and server. So the core system that is underneath is really this different service packages. That one is really the Instant Hub, which does all the registration and load balancing and distribution and cache hashes. So if you already requested something, he knows where in the network the caches are and everything. Then the instant service do really the heavy lifting. So they do actually manage all the jobs, so do data transcoding, rendering, culling, searching, tracking, everything that really starts with data, that performs on data, provides an API and then produces the data. So, and they are managed throughout the network. The interesting part is that some of these jobs produce new data, which can be delivered through the cache infrastructure. And there we mainly use now HTTP 2 because it's really helps us to limit the request friction. Good. So an old slide, but still pretty valid. What we would like achieve with this hybrid rendering is that we can deal with this different drawbacks from pure client-side and pure server-based rendering, because pure client-side rendering has some really great aspects. You can use the resources you have on your client, but also there's some things that you have to consider, like security. You always transmit your 3D data to the client. And on the other hand, server-side rendering seems to be a good solution, but it doesn't really scale. So if you go from 20,000 to 20 million user, you really need hundreds of thousands of boxes in your network. So it really makes sense to utilize both infrastructures. And we believe right now that the best way is the middle, where you distribute really this computation process. And what the side effect is that we also can increase the amount of data that we can really put through. So one really old video, but it's still the core reference that we had. I come to newer results in a second, but this shows the very first culling that we did on the Boeing. It's an old reference that is already 2-3 years old, where we tested the essential pipeline of the whole idea. But it's still a nice reference for how this server-side culling and then client-side rendering and patching work. So it's really rendered on the client. He transmits the data to the client and then has a high interactive behavior. So it never really scripts the frame rate. And so it's still the goal that we try to achieve. And there are a couple of other examples where we really integrated this in PLM systems, where you can download directly from industrial databases and can do the transcoding and everything automatically, and directly really identify URNs from the original data in your application, and the whole infrastructure cares about translating, caching, visualization. So that's really neat. Another aspect I just would like to mention again, because all of the data is mostly CAD data, 1 minute, but we care about quality. So the next work that is going into the system is really this, how to harmonize this physical basis coding, then to transmit the parts to the client. So thin application is something we worked on with this infrastructure already. And then, of course, the EDF data set, which was also in the system, which was this, it's not too many polygons, just 30 million polygons, but it has 230,000 groups and 400,000 primitives that really needs to be tessellated and rendered in real time. And this works quite nicely. Unfortunately, I don't have time for demo, but we're going to demo this tomorrow, this data set running over Wi-Fi on my Node.gpu notebook. So, conclusion. So what we introduce is really a new idea. It's not a DOMS-based system. It's this system that really tries to minimize the effort on the client side, that it really concentrates what does an application developer and a user really needs. And this is really this minimal set of functions to model the behavior between the system. Then we have this adaptive and secure visualization. It's really important. Plug-in-free, of course, so the new system doesn't use any optional plugins or Flash or anything. It's just pure WebGL 1, or it's really built for WebGL 2. And a fully automated pipeline, so it's not that you set up it. And it's a new portal. So the instant3dhub.org portal just went up like 2 days ago or so, and there's not yet too much information, but we will, as with the instant reality and X-Freedom portal, we will use this as a platform to get documentation and the system and demos and everything. Yeah.
Thank you very much. We have one quick question.
Johannes, that seems to, this infrastructure seems to depend on a back-end database. Have a comment on that? What kind of database is needed, or is it agnostic?
It's totally agnostic. There's this interface. It's totally HTTPS based, and we only get data. We never really write new data to the 3D model provider. That's a really important part. But we really care a lot about identification of the original data, not just in the data set, but also in the parts. So that people that build an application on the other side, really, if they have this, if they click on data or anything, they directly know what the original data set from the database was.
Thank you, Johannes. This is really impressive work. I was wondering, because I assume that you can handle network condition changes during the simulation. And in such case, it happens that you may need to transform your simulation from the client to the server. How do you handle
that's not what we can do right now. So we cannot.
It's not possible. Because I was wondering, how can you handle the state transition, but you don't do it. Okay.
So we can build really hybrid results where we mix client-based rendering with server-based rendering. But right now the system works that it has a startup phase where it really checks, okay what machine do I have, what network do I have, and then decides what part of the actually setup really is rendering.
Okay. All right, thank you. My name is Filip Stanzoluk. I'm an associate professor of computer science and information technology at
Armstrong State University, Savannah, Georgia. And I'm going to present an X3D solution for sensor-based thermal mapping of residential and commercial buildings. The motivation, I'm going to start with a brief motivation. I'm going to briefly mention the thermal modeling, a very brief review, a few words about thermal comfort, humidity and temperature monitoring system that we are using based on an Arduino system, data acquisition and X3 data representation. I'm going to say just a few words about scalability and validation. So first of all, a lot of governments are looking into sustainable methods of construction, which means as close to zero carbon passive buildings, passive heating technologies, passive cooling technologies, and so on. Unfortunately, the thermally deficient Western methods of constructions create a huge problem. Most of these methods of constructions have been applied throughout the world, especially for commercial buildings. Specifically in subtropical climates, I had the chance to visit Thailand a couple of years ago, and there are many, many buildings that are basically using similar technologies like in northern US, but the climate is completely different. You have extremely hot climate, extremely high, humid climate, a lot of sun exposure for the buildings, and so on. And some of these buildings have partial subsidiary, energy subsidiaries from the state, but that's changing, and the owners and the companies that are involved are looking for solutions to improve the efficiency of the building envelope. So our proposed system, there are many others actually, but our proposed system is cost effective. It's a cost effective solution for seasonal monitoring. So we use a set of sensors that we display in the building.
It's simple, scalable, it allows web-based visualization of 3D thermal maps. It allows, or it facilitates the decision-making process in terms of improving the building, making some architectural modifications to the building envelope. And it does not use any licensed software. Everything's independent packages, and it doesn't rely on any kind of licensed solutions. A very big view of thermal modeling, there are many, many conventional models for thermal representation, and they are mainly used by construction professionals, also by air conditioning engineers. National Institute of Building Sciences, they are proposing standards for performance of the building envelope from the energy efficiency standpoint, measurements and also verification. These measurements are sometimes done in the design phase, but material properties are also very important, so sometimes some of the assessment is done after construction. A little bit of a forward step has been done in California on the western coast. They lay ground for the adoption of zero net energy, ZNet, ready code, by 2020. So they are trying to use solar energy to completely reduce the carbon emission for cooling, mainly for cooling houses. Many, many thermal analysis software products are available. SolidWorks is quite popular. SolidWorks simulations, ANSI Advantage, CFX also model. Mainly they are based on CAD-based models and integration. In the last 20 years, there were a lot of efforts that were using computational fluid dynamics, but the simulations are using proprietary system, and most of the times are too complex, and they're actually not applied on a real system. They use some demo versions, but when you have real-time data, it's pretty difficult to apply them. I'm just mentioning here a few authors. Thermographic-based infrared imaging has been used to visualize actual thermal resistance and condensation problems in buildings. Lee, for example, in 2014 measured the impact of clothing insulation for the envelope of the building, using a software component called Energy Plus, and so on. Just a few words about thermal comfort. Thermal comfort is a fairly complex problem. It has two components, an environmental and a personal one. The personal component deals obviously with clothing, which is a layer of insulation for the human and also for the metabolic heart rate. The environmental component that we are focusing on deals with humidity, air velocity, air temperature, and radiant temperature. The air velocity, we are not really dealing with that. We don't have currently a sensor system that measures air velocity. So we are looking at the laminar flow, basically when there's no turbulent movements of air in the building. There are some authors that conduct the thermal comfort and occupant behavior surveys in under different scenarios, for example, in the region of Japan, and they look at how people adapt to humid and hot conditions by using air movement, basically. This is behavioral adaptation. Pitts was looking at transition spaces, entrance foyers, and circulation zones, stairways, and so on, other components of internal buildings, mainly commercial buildings. And there are many opportunities to reduce environmental conditioning by regulating the flow of heat or cold air in such spaces. A very brief overview of our humidity and temperature monitoring sensor. We are basically computing the relative humidity, which depends on the function of temperature and humidity. We are using a quite popular Arduino Uno system. The sensors are connected, the humidity and temperature sensors are connected to a small transceiver, a Bluetooth transceiver. We can have up to 14 transceivers in one room. The sensors are placed at different locations in the room. For example, they could be placed on the corners or in the middle of the walls. And they report the data to a central tablet or personal computer. And data is collected at a frequency of roughly of one measurement a second. And the sensors can run for a couple of weeks or even months, and we can collect the data throughout the entire season, actually. This is the a little bit more detailed data acquisition module, Sensilion sensor, which is extremely small, that collects the temperature and humidity, high accuracy, fairly high accuracy. We don't really need an extremely high accuracy, actually, because we take many, many measurements, but this accuracy is below 0.1 Celsius degree. High reliability for the network also. As I mentioned, it's a 1 hertz update, once a second. A very simple communication protocol. The data buffer is basically consumed by the data acquisition client, which can be a laptop or a tablet, or even a cell phone, and can be stored on that, or can be actually saved on a mass storage device for later use. Now, how do we use all that data? Well, we looked at the X3D data representation, and we tried to obtain a volumetric representation for the air. So we looked at several nodes, roughly, and fog node, for example. We have a representation of the fog node on the right side there. And then we explored also X3D primitives, you know, like cubes, a box basically, spheres, in fact, even billboards. Even though this is actually not a volumetric, it's basically, it gives the impression of volumetric rendering. I mean, of course, you have a flat screen. What you see at the bottom there is a representation of temperature based on using a set of spheres. Of course, it's not very efficient if you use spheres because there's many polygons, so if you have to use a that large set of spheres, you know, the frame rate will drop significantly. To allow a better visualization of the temperature in the room, we have a scenario here with semi-transparent walls and also wireframe rendering, basically. On the left side, you have a residential building. It's basically a house where we put sensors in the corner of this room and in the middle of the walls. And on the right side, you have a commercial building. Now, one level of that building has sensors. The rest of the data for the upper layers has been basically fed in, simulated, because we don't have yet enough sensors made up. The sensors are actually quite small and quite inexpensive. One sensor system with the Bluetooth and with the emitted sensor is around $5, so it's not expensive at all. Now, in terms of scalability for large buildings, if you use polygonal elements, if you use billboards, for example, you can have a frame rate of 15, the target was 15 frames per second. Now, if you try to model an entire street or an entire neighborhood from this point of view, assuming you already have the data from the sensors. Again, let me mention, the sensors can be placed in the building and they run on batteries for up to 3 months, so you can leave them there for 3 months, collect the data, and then process and play back the simulation in X3D in whatever time frame you decide. Sensor data is collected once a second. So scalability to large region is possible. We have three choices. We can make it fully interactive. If we make it fully interactive, then basically the user can navigate through the neighborhood and can choose a specific building. We are in the development of the algorithm that would automatically select a specific building and add the data only to the building that has been selected. If you get the bird's eye view, the building envelope will be modeled, basically. Only the temperature on the building envelope will be modeled. As you enter the building, the room, the specific room, will basically be filled in with basic primitives, even billboards, some level of transparency, to give the impression of the thermal map in color, basically. So this would allow users to kind of have an idea throughout the day and night, throughout the week, or throughout the season, how does the temperature and the humidity evaluate or move inside the building, and potentially find out the areas that need to be remodeled or re-engineered to improve the efficiency of the building. We also have the capability to have a non-interactive, which is kind of an animation, just running the data and presenting that to the user. And again, with a better battery system, you can actually run a monitoring system for a full year and obtain
seasonal data as well as daily. We started a pre-validation. The validation was done using an infrared camera system. So we took a picture, an infrared camera, thermographic picture basically of a building. This is basically the pixel-based color of the temperature. And we did generate a mock-up model, an XVD model. And we used sensor data to try to simulate a similar temperature map. Again, this is a pre-validation, it's not a full validation yet. We're looking into generating an automatic validation scheme that would allow us to use thermographic cameras to validate maps, the temperature maps at a certain moment in time. As you know, thermographic cameras are using, or basically can be used in buildings, but they are quite expensive and they do not provide data for a long time, which is basically just a frame. So use the thermographic camera for a couple of minutes, you get the map, and then, you know, an hour later, the map can be completely different, depending on the environment. So very brief conclusion. So we try to provide a very basic and cost-effective system for temperature and humidity monitoring. We're looking towards developing a scalable X3D system to visualize, to allow us to visualize 3D thermal maps. The usefulness of the system is in early design of buildings and also in later modifications of the building envelope. I'd like to thank my co-authors, Professor Paul Bolza at the University of Brașov, Romania, research assistant during the goods, and my collaborator at Georgia Southern University, Marcel Maghiar. If you have additional questions, you know, you can find more information on my website, or you can send me an email. I'm not sure how we stay with time. It's probably not that great, but 40, so I can take one question.
Thanks for the impressive presentation. My question is concerning the validation you want to do with thermal images. So you want to validate your simulation results, right?
Yes.
Or, because
the sensor data.
The problem with thermal imagery is that it strongly depends on our environmental conditions. For example, if you have, say, rain.
That's right.
The facade, or if you
That's right.
Some water in the facade, it will be completely different. So I guess it would be quite hard to use the thermal imagery.
Yes, we're looking actually, this can be divided in two, inside thermal, the inside envelope and the outside envelope. Basically, with thermography, you can, it's pretty much like taking a picture. You take a picture, things will change in the next second maybe, or the next hour, and so on. So that's why thermographic imaging helps, but if you really want to do a long-term monitoring of the thermal condition in a building, you need to have some kind of sensor system that basically monitors the data throughout the day, at least throughout the day and throughout the night, because you'll have, you know, sunlight going through the windows, you'll have people opening doors and things like that. So I think using a sensor-based system, you can get a much more accurate representation of what's happening in the building from a thermal point of view. And collecting data for large periods of time, then you can even provide information to the user in terms of winter time, summer time, thermal maps, and identify, I mean, the main reason for this simulation, or one of the reasons for this simulation, is to be able to identify flaws in the building, also in the design of the building, and then try to re-engineer that or try to fix those problems. And that's really difficult to do with a thermographic camera, because you basically have to spend there, you know, days after days. But this inexpensive sensor system, you can actually leave it there. Potentially, you can change and move the sensors around. As I said, one of the sensors is roughly $5. If you go in mass production, you know, you can probably drop it to $1 or $2. And then you can have, using Bluetooth, two levels, you can have 14 sensors in each room. So, you know, multiply that by 10, 140 sensors, you can monitor basically a small office with 10 rooms for a period of 3 months. Collect all the data, and then it's up to you how you want to play. We get data once a second, so you can play the whole thing in like a minute if you want,
to see how the temperature changes and render that on the web directly. So there's no more overhead in terms of installing complex software or doing any kind of simulation that would use additional functions. So you use raw data, basically, to see the temperature. Thank you.
And let's thank our speaker.
So I guess our next speaker is Nicolas.
Okay, so I'm here to present some of our work on 3D portrayal and the preparation of geospatial data, preparation and delivery. This is a work, the paper was written, the lead author is Ji-Sun Kim, who's a colleague of mine at Virginia Tech, and Peter Sporza, who's the director for our Center for Geospatial Information Technology. So we have been working with our 3D Blacksburg project for some time, and we really found that there was a lack of practical data and advice on all the different options that are available for 3D portrayal, right? X3D is very general purpose. There's a lot of ways to design a system. There's a lot of ways to shoot yourself in the foot. So we wanted to figure out what does the landscape look like and some of the trade-offs involved in building these systems. It fits in a lot with the work on compressed binary encodings as well. So hopefully that the data and the method that we're presenting here can be useful in future evaluations. So as you know, we in geospatial land, we have lots of layers of data. Often we want to fuse them, show them in concert. Typically, we're dealing with different kinds of sources. So the data might be coming from a raster image, like a height map for elevation, for example. Or there might be vectors for a building foundation, such as a shape file. Or we might have different kinds of geometries, like a triangulated irregular network for terrain and a locality. There's a lot of uses that we see for 3D Blacksburg and 3D Virginia. I'm just showing a few here, and of course there are sources. But urban planning, RF propagation modeling is something we're very into at Virginia Tech with a number of our spectrum sharing applications. I presented last year the Cornet tool that is continuing development. Floodplains and underground utilities are some of the things that we're using 3D Blacksburg for. Across all of these different data sources coming from different places, you know, using standards lets us do a lot of these kind of mashups that we would like to do, data fusion. And so we're really looking at the OGC Web View service and Web3D service and X3D as a delivery or portrayal technology for those databases. So what we did is we worked on the Web3D service out of OGC. We built on GeoServer, and we collected basically the latest and greatest data for our area in Blacksburg, and processed it several different ways through various tools also. Sometimes we were inside the Esri stack dealing with their kinds of toolkits. Wherever we could, we were using GDAL and some of the open Python tools to process the different geospatial data into our database. And as you can see, we're using GeoServer. This is an open source Java framework that runs on top of PostGIS. PostGIS is really great. It lets you do a lot of spatial queries, which is of course key for geo applications, but also it actually has some very good X3D support. If you didn't know, you can automatically get query results as X3D instead of triangles, for example. And that's built into the RDBMS. So this was a kind of a sweet spot, and we noticed that there were some folks in the OGC community working in GeoServer out of Portugal. And so we picked up on their work and developed the system I will describe. So, as I said, there's lots of different representations, lots of different encodings you might choose in an application like this. We know that we want to support multiple levels of detail, and we know that we're bringing in different kinds of representations, for example, of our terrain or buildings, and trying to find the common denominator. Okay, so here's a kind of a view of our pipeline or the procedure. We have LiDAR data for the town, we have elevation grids, we can do lots of neat things about finding the bare earth or the edge of a building, for example. A lot of the geospatial data then that gets created, you know, it's typically of those three kinds I mentioned. You know, you might have a TIN, which is basically just a triangle polygon made of triangles. You might have a grid, which is something more like a regular raster or an elevation grid node, as you might think of in X3D. And then building footprints. And we want to put these things together. We want to texture the terrain. Maybe it's with the OpenStreetMap, maybe it's with Open Aerial Map, maybe it's with some data that we collected. Okay, so we've got all of these things together. And we put them into the database. Basically, to test two aspects of the representation and the encoding. Okay, and so I'll get into these aspects next. So in the one case, we put data into PostGIS, various point geometry, TIN, and basically the idea that was here, okay, I'm gonna do a query on this database, and I'm only gonna pull out the things that I need, right? So I'm only gonna get the area of interest and get the terrain inside there, the buildings inside there. At the level that we had started with, that actually was, as you'll see, prohibitively expensive. It seemed that generating these geometries on the fly out of the server was not going to be very scalable. So we started to look at some other methods. The one is at the bottom is that we're actually just saying, okay, there's a 3D model at this point in space. And that 3D model is actually at this URL over here. So the model itself is not in the database, but its reference point is. Okay, and so this is the idea about how kind of to speed up, to use some of the spatial query things that PostGIS gives you, but use the file system and the web as actually the archive of the data. Okay, so what did we do? We set up a set of experiments where we processed grid data and TIN data. In one set of cases, we put those into the PostGIS database so we could do dynamic queries. In another set, we just did this URL-based reference, okay, in the database, and then loaded those models from the file system. We did a set of measurements. We used the timing API in the browser to figure out basically what the different kinds of responses were as we downloaded the models. And we really tried to load them several times and then average those results, since one load might be the moment that someone's downloading the YouTube next door, right? Quick results, in the case of generating dynamically out of the database, you can see we really ran into some major problems. Both some cases did not finish, and other ones just took much too long. If we're talking about, say, 32, trying to deliver 32 tiles. Each of these has four LODs and buildings and so on. So the dynamic aspect was not so satisfying in our case. However, then we look at some of the encodings for the X3D scene, and binary geometry, something that we might expect. The Fraunhofer, this was 1.5, I believe, is that this was running, and so that was an AOPT version where we just used the binary geometry compression that shipped with AOPT. And we kind of see there's some trade-offs here, and this is hopefully the value of this, that we can publish the method and the result and help people to kind of navigate these trade-offs. But the tin size was very difficult to scale, and especially even though it was very easy to process to an index face set or something, it was difficult to deliver. So we really found that, as you might expect, the binary geometry with the URL reference scheme was the most efficient. So you can say maybe from these results that we're dealing with the larger areas of interest and complex models. Certainly the binary geometry is the way to go, but that these should be also pre-processed into the tiles, so that you don't need to construct this geometry on the fly from the database, basically is the lesson here for us. We use that to develop, here's our 3D Blacksburg application, or one of them. You can see the 3D campus map with buildings and place markers here in the top. This is the X Freedom view. And we have Google Street coding, so you can grab addresses. Each of these overlay markers are actually the locations of historical photos. So from our Virginia Tech Library, 1932, you can see all the turkeys running around the quad. I'm just kidding. But a lot of really interesting historical photos, which are here listed as annotations, and they're geo-referenced in the database. You can see using OpenStreetMap down here to define what's the spatial extent of our query. And that custom request here is your Web3DS request, which you can see in the bottom right. So we have used this to develop a couple of applications that we're using now. One is the historical inventory I described. Here's some pictures of the old buildings on campus. Down there, here's our president's house. Back in probably 1932, this was taken. And then also using this for looking at broadband inventory, towers, where can we put new cell towers for better coverage. This is another application that we've used this base data set for. Very exciting as it continues to go forward. We're using this spatial data infrastructure in several ways. We did just start processing our statewide LiDAR information, which is insanely precise and large. But also using web-based tools like to select a site for a new winery, or maybe to say what kind of crops would grow well in these certain conditions. These are all real funded projects that we're using this system for. And I'm excited to go, after here I'll be going to Burkina Faso in Africa to take this as a water mapping tool to Africa. So I'm very excited to see how it will work in there. In the coming months and year, we have several new projects that we're working on. We just got funded one. We work with our biological systems engineers to basically keep our watersheds clearer. So they're doing laser scans of stream beds, looking at shade of the stream for the fish for fish and water quality. And so we'll be integrating a lot of sensor data from different locations in Virginia. So thank you for your attention. I'm happy to talk with you more about our work.
Thank you. Any questions for Nicholas? We have time for at least a question.
We have two questions. One
yes.
More technical. How do you manage
the fact that the possibility to request some portion of the 3D model using this reference system outside the database. And one not so technical about which is the effort to prepare the background data before to starting to deploy the service.
Okay, good questions. Yeah, so the first one was about specifying the area of the query. How do you request the models from the system? So I'll show sort of here on the bottom center is a typical 2D map interface, which it'll basically lets you give a bounding box for your query. The OGC Web3D service provides you several different parameters. It's hard to see here, but it includes that bounding box area and then which layers you're requesting. So in this way you can, and also you have to put in your spatial datum, the EPSG code or something like that on the query. In terms of the processing, yes, we wrote a set of Python scripts basically to work with GDAL and handle the tiling and slicing of the elevation data and the image tiles. However, in the case of OpenStreetMap, we did have to. I think we had to code over to UTM and then back again. I think this is how I'm recalling it. But you can only get to OpenStreetMap data with one set of coordinates, and the Web3D service is much more flexible. So.
Thank you, Nicholas.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
My talk is about the volumetric texture data completion scheme for production. My name is Yeonsu, I'm from Toshiba in Japan. So we joined this consortium from this March. So for those of you who doesn't know well about our company, so this is our company's mission, committed to people, committed to the future. Focuses on to of respect for the people and value creation and contribution to society. So, if you see the right side of the slide, you can see the five groups of our business field, and the red square is the division where I belong to, which call industrial ICT solution company. We collaborate with these five groups, which are energy infrastructure group and communities solution group and healthcare system and services group and electronic devices and component group and lifestyle products and service group, which is famous for the laptops and television and video. So my talk composed with three parts. First is about the application, and second one is how we implement X3D and X3DOM, and the third one is volumetric texture data compression scheme, which we do measurement. So about the application usage, the domain is the disaster prevention by forecasting heavy rainfall. So and this work is on this. We are using this application with demonstration experiment from yesterday, actually 2005. And the system is the Osaka Prefecture's surge pumping system, and so we are and road information announcement system. And the purpose of it is to help decision making with rainfall information, whether or not to switch on the sewage pumping system and fluvial and road information announcement system to the citizens where they live. And we are using real-time data observation, which can be observed by this, we call it phased array with weather radar. So it is also funded by the government and developed by our for all of our group in Toshiba, and then and it's work collaborative with the Osaka University. So how much real time? Compared to parabolic radar, it the right side in 10 to 30 seconds, one single cycle can scan 100 angles of every elevation. So its radius is 60 kilometers. So to develop this social support semiconductor technology is used. So when you get the data, we be processing this. So when we scan the data, we measure the data. It was on the polar coordinates, and we interpolated into uniform Cartesian coordinates. And then we generate 2D extraterrestrial image. As you may all know, X-ray TOM doesn't support 3D X-ray yet, so we are looking forward to wheelchair 2.0 for this month. So, this is explanation about the functional requirements in our application. So the left side is 3D view, and the right side is the 2D view, which is based on map services. So when you design this, we think about the 3D is when it is stuck. Stop, but it doesn't, user cannot easily accept it is 3D or just 2D projected. So we put the animation feature and the time varying parameter data, and then we synchronize the 2D to 3D data also, and the we design interactivity for if the user just up to it some certain kind of time stamp, then the application can get the data very fast. So how we implement with X3D and X3 DOM? So adaptive technologies are for ubiquity, we use based on the web application, browser-based vector recognition, and then based on WebGL API, we use the declarative X3D, X3 DOM library. And based on visualization algorithm, we use 3D volume ray testing with transfer functions. And based on geographical information, we use the two open layers 2D map and 3D map with the 3D elevation grid, which is provided by the Japanese Geological Service Institute. So this is how the contents look like. Use the existing volume-related nodes. We couldn't find how the picture there, how we could put the polygons on the below the volume, and then volumes together. So we looked up the instant reality feature, which has the depth map. Here. So we add the radar volume style mode here, and then it has the child mode as the render texture, and it has depth map field, so we can render in right way. So we are coming to X3 DOM soon. Radar volume style and compression field, which I will explain afterward. We're using structures, structures with the compression feature. So copy the compression scheme. So considerations were transfer time and bypass. The system is designed as a 20 megabyte BPS network speed, and then we considered to keep image quality, so we are using PNG instead of lossy JPEG, and rendering performance, GPU limit print. This, we take three steps as a operation. First, we use the grayscale distributed address and chain and put them the RGBL channel stack on, and then we did DXT file compression, and then we deflate it. So RGBL channel stack means we use each RGBA channels, and then we put on 1 and 5, 9 with the R channel, and then green is zero. So 8x8 goes to 4x4. And this DXT5 conversion scheme is I refer to this paper as here. We use this feature and we downside on quarter and we deflate it. So this is experimental measurement, so we downside and divide size. The raw size was 4 megabytes, and then when we do RGB channel, it goes to 1 megabyte, and finally we do every 3 steps, then we go to 0.184 megabytes. And we also checked how the deflate time takes. So we think it doesn't have any problem with this system environment. We use the Core i5 CPU. So to summarize, as well as Jericho, we choose X3D, X3GOM, which is open and standard, so we could extend it, and we can application use, developers can easily use. And for interactivity and 2D synchronization, we implemented texture visit based animation instead of movie streaming the movie. And to save file size and transfer time without losing image quality, we found out backing the data in RGB channels followed by DXT5 and deflate compression is most useful in our case. So, thank you.
Thank you very much for your talk. Any questions for Ms. Yangso, Ms. Yangso, please go ahead. Yes, RC.
Thanks for the interesting talk. I have a short question about the data. I think I didn't really get it, what the data was about. So this like risk of rainfall, we are used to it from the news that we see a 2D map and then some heat map or whatever. But here that was really volumetric. So what did actually, what does the system measure in 3D?
Okay, thank you for the question.
Live demo. Amazing.
So if we see the 22D, then we don't know where is the core of the community, the cloud core of the rain. So we think that this can influence user more.
Yeah, but what is the data actually? Is it rainfall or
this one?
So it's clouds. It's actually clouds.
Yes, clouds.
Ah, okay. Thanks. Oh, I didn't understand it. Thanks. And you combine via the depth map that with the terrain model?
Yes.
Ah, very cool. Thanks.
Thank you.
Especially having a demo from Japan is always impressive.
Sorry.
Thank you very much.
I have a quick question for you. Can we see the demo on the website, or is it any copyright? We have the next presenter, which is the last presenter from the second paper session. Shortly after, we'll have the lunch break. The title is Hybrid Visualization of Digital Production Big Data. So the buzzword here is big data. And Alan Evans will present us a way to visualize it, a hybrid way to do it.
Hi everyone, thanks for the introduction. My name is Alan Evans. I'm associate lecturer at Universitat Pompeu Fabra in Barcelona in Spain. And I'm here to talk about production. So film production, cinema production, digital production in general, and the vast amount of data that's been recorded in the course of a typical production. So we all can imagine if you go with your video camera to record the latest Godzilla film or, you know, Avengers, whatever you want, you've got these very high resolution cameras. But with the advantage of, with the advent, should I say, of cheap storage, now there's no excuse not to record absolutely everything on the set. So you're not just recording the actual footage from your extremely high resolution 4K red camera or whatever it is, you're recording every single thing you can about the set. Why are you doing that? Well, you're doing it not just to drive decisions on set, but you're doing it to drive and assist the post-production process, right? You're taking in images of everything so that when you're adding in your special effects later on, you have as much of the real original data as possible. And again, the problem with this cheap storage is that you record everything, you don't really care about compression or whatever it is, you just dump it on some vast array of, you know, 20 terabyte hard drives, and you just store all this information. And what types of information are you storing? Well, you're storing a lot of it's point cloud data, so laser scan data of the set. A lot of it might be reconstructed point cloud data, so if you take a spheron, a series of spherons, and you can reconstruct a point cloud from those spherons. Or you may just take buckets of static images with a DSLR and then reconstruct those in some sort of mesh or point cloud representations. You're storing all that data, and it typically is hundreds of megabytes in size. The other thing you're going to store as well is what's called witness cameras. So you have your main camera or main cameras recording the footage, but you'll have several smaller, less expensive cameras arranged in a circle or however anything you want on the outside that are recording the general action so that it can be used in post-production to drive the special effects or digital effects that are going to be added later on in post. And so to give you an example, this is a typical point cloud. Obviously rendering these point clouds in an offline context is trivial, but this is a typical point cloud. I think this is from the University of Surrey courtyard actually, and this is 600 megabytes for this point cloud, right, in uncompressed fashion, uncompressed format. So all of these are used, and the problem at the moment is that the visualization of this multimodal data is almost invariably done in individual separate tools. So we're all familiar with things like Maya or Studio Max or whatever it is to visualize mesh data and materials and things like that. Pretty much everyone I'm here in the room either is aware of or has used MeshLab to visualize point clouds and meshes and so on and so forth. You won't know this tool on the right. It's called Jigsaw. It's a proprietary tool from Double Negative, the visual media production company in London, which we've been working on this project. And that's basically an organizational tool to help group different files and images and videos together. But the point is that every single one of these formats, whether it's 3D point clouds, whether it's images, static image, whether it's video, or whether it's other sort of data, like audio data or so on, all of which are viewed in separate applications. And that means that you have to see the data, you have to open up that application and view it, and remember what you saw 5 minutes ago in the other application, or tab between them. And there is a need, therefore, of some way of visualizing this data in one integrated environment, if you like, right? Because it gives you a holistic view of the 3D space that you use to record your data. And I guess I'm preaching to the converted here, but like I'm gonna, you know, every time I go to present in a graphics conference, I have to sell this point. You know, the web is the ideal medium for this kind of stuff, right? The browser is the ideal medium for this kind of stuff. It's inherently multi-platform. You skip all these problems with platform independence and compiling all that kind of stuff. Most importantly, and this is the really big thing, we all use Google Drive and Dropbox and all these things right now. So in our general workflow, we're used to cloud-based and collaborative workflow. And that hasn't yet transposed its way to the production world yet, but at least not in the 3D sense. So the fact that the web is the driver for all these cloud and collaborative workflows, that's a really good argument for making a 3D or a hybrid 2D 3D environment of the web as well. And finally, the web is fantastic for mixing different modalities of data, right? You can very easily dump in a 3D context and WebGL in the background and then paint some 2D HTML or some HTML5 video or whatever's on top of it. And you can mix and match all these different modalities very easily in a single context, right? And so that's what we're working on right now. And this paper is a short paper, it's a work in progress showing you some of our work that we've been doing in generating application, which I think demonstrates the power of such an approach. Of course, to do all this, you need to have the source data. We're working with the coordinators of this FP7 project in Europe called IMPART, and IMPART's dealing exclusively on treating big data in the production environment. And what may be of interest to you, if you're interested in big data, is that there is a publicly available data set. If you go to this URL here from the University of Surrey, you can apply and be granted almost certainly access to this data, which is several terabytes of data of simulated on-set data. So it's LiDAR scans, many of which have been registered with some pretty advanced algorithms. It's like reconstructions from spherons, from RGBD cameras from Kinect, and so on and so forth. There are witness camera footages there. All of it's been registered into a unified 3D space. So you, from a visualization point of view, all you need to do is take this data and dump it into your whatever algorithm you're going to try to use. And you can see it. So it's very, very powerful, and I urge you all to use it and download it for your test because it's free. So the goal is to generate a web application which combines several things, right? Multiple point clouds in a 3D scene, multiple videos positions at the camera locations within the 3D scene, and the original images and the positions of the sensors. So if you think you've got a unified 3D scene presenting you how the set looked like and all of its input data, right? So we've got these three things we need to tackle. The first is multi-resolution point cloud. So if this point cloud is very big, you need to try and stream it and transmit it over the web in a progressive kind of way. Obviously, you have progressive loading of meshes, which has been done in various different places before. We published a technique last year at CBMP on multi-resolution point clouds. I'm just going to jump out quickly to see. I do have some internet, so I'm going to see if this works. It's a certain thing. Let's just maximize this. So this is an example of loading in the point clouds. I think some of this is cached, actually, so it makes it work so fast. But you can see, you get the idea of how a lower resolution version of the point cloud is downloaded first, and then loads it in a higher resolution later on. And you can see there are actually several different point clouds in here, so I can disable the sphere on, disable the LiDAR. This is a point cloud here from a Kinect reconstruction, which is a nice example. You can just activate different modalities that are coming from different point clouds and so on. So that works quite nicely. And then the other thing we need to do is have videos in 3D scenes. So what we did here was we have, for each witness camera, we have a matrix which basically represents the position and rotation of that camera within the 3D scene. And that's work that's been done by our partners at the University of Surrey, actually, which is quite interesting, and is referenced in the paper. And basically, with that matrix, we can just basically dump a straight mesh plane into our 3D scene. And with the HTML video element, just pipe every frame, the image from the video, as a WebGL texture and paint it on the mesh. So let's just go back and see that as well, given this is working. We'll go to our cathedral scene. There it loads in the data. I'm just going to click down here, and you can see here is the point cloud in the background with this bit here is the mesh plane with the video. And so I press play, I can see the video of Hansung here running and jumping. And I can skip around to different videos to move around and see how the thing's going. And there's scrubbing and pausing and stopping all working. This is all, this is a 3D web context here. This is a 2D Java sort of canvas here, painting all the stuff at the bottom. And then there's like HTML5 video data being piped in every frame. And it works very, very smoothly and very, very well, I think. So we're quite pleased about that way of mixing. It's why I call it hybrid visualization. You're mixing in several data aspects in real time, which is quite good. And the final thing we need to talk about is this sensor positions. So we're just going to zoom up here and see if I just hide a couple of these point clouds here. I'll hide the LiDAR and hide the spheron. This point cloud here is a reconstruction basically done from these original source images. So here are the source images down here that were taken of this cathedral. And these are the positions where the cameraman was where he took the images. So these have been reconstructed as well. So if I just click on, for example, this one here, then I've got no internet. So if I had internet here, then it would be loading me this original image in high resolution. So we could see the original, whatever resolution it was, image there. And so that's quite a nice idea because you get to see the original data that was used to make this point cloud. Just as an extra bonus as well, something that wasn't in the paper, something we've been working on, is annotation. We've got this nice annotation tool now where I click on here, and I just click on here and say, these are some steps. And I'll just deactivate this tool now, and just debug mode. Now, so if I move around this around now, then I have annotated on the point cloud, which requires a little bit of trouble because you can't cast a ray to hit the point clouds, you have to cast a ray into an octree and make sure the point cloud points are in the octree, so that probably doesn't work. But now you've got annotation in the 3D scene as well, and it raises the goal, really, of some producer on the beach in Hollywood, sunning himself, looking at the set while the workers are hard work away in London, right, or wherever they are, and saying, no, I don't like this camera, move this camera to one, here and there. So this real-time collaboration over the web via a web-based interface, that's the kind of goal we're working towards. So the annotation stuff is not in the paper, unfortunately, so you just get a little sneak peek of it there. Right, so I've just done the demo. So just to recap very briefly on those three elements, the hybrid elements I talked about. So we've got the multi-resolution point clouds based on our work last year. We've got this video being piped into the scene in real time, which links back to the web conference stuff we saw this morning, actually, in the very first talk. And we've got these original sensor positions, which is basically mixing in standard HTML with a 3D context. What we're working on right now is actually adding a bit more compression to it. Right now, those point clouds are just being transmitted X, Y, Z, and RGB. No spectacular interest in terms of compression, but I think if we use some bounding box quantization, we can reduce the bit depth and maybe even follow the UTF-8 and delta encoding approach that WebGL Loader do for the compression of their meshes. I'm not sure that the delta encoding is going to work so well for the point clouds because it's quite a large space in between the nodes of the octree which you use to generate a point cloud. But that's something we have to look into. Obviously then we've got a mesh reconstruction from those point clouds as well. And so we're playing around. What I'm working on right now is actually efficient mesh rendering, progressive meshing, and playing around with the 32-bit element index buffer to try and generate some real big meshes. Because the meshes are ultimately millions of polys, and so they require a reasonably robust approach to get them registered properly. You don't have that problem with a point cloud, of course, as an index buffer. So, and that's, we've got some simple preliminary results there. Hopefully we'll be able to present them next year. So, just to conclude, hopefully on time, I think. I don't need to tell you, but I'm telling you again, and I'm telling you again, the browser is an excellent context visualization of multimodal 3D, and not just of 3D, but all sorts of multimodal data. I guess that's the take-home message that I want from this talk, is that the browser is a really spectacular way of mixing in video and even audio, I guess. Just an aside, a few years ago, we published a paper on dumping in textures in an OpenGL context, video textures in an OpenGL context. And it requires a bit of engineering, right? You've got to decode the video, you've got to extract the frames of the image, you've got to create the texture, and blah, 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 and put it in the OpenGL. And via the web, it's just a case of creating a HTML5 video element and grabbing the texture every frame and dumping it in. And it works really well and really quickly. And so the second conclusion is the web is a natural, leads itself naturally to collaborative workflows. And our work with annotation, I think, is the goal we're trying to push there and try and sell that to our colleagues in Double Negative and the industry to see if we can really convince them this is a useful thing. And I think the final point is a warning. I think data distribution, we saw a great talk earlier from Johannes showing some interesting work about data distribution and whether to calculate on the server or on the client and so on. That's always going to be an issue. It's always going to be a problem. I think in our field, it's something that we really have to battle consistently to overcome. But I think we're getting there. And I think there's really some promising approaches, both for meshes and for point clouds and for volumetric rendering and so on. And I think that current work generally in the community is very promising. That's all I have to say. If you want to access the data set, please do so. If you want to find out more about IMPART or our work, then here are two links. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, thank you to our presenters. We are right on time. We do have time for one question, and then we have lunch after. So, any questions?
How big is the data amount of your model you show here for the point clouds?
Yeah.
Is that possible to use 3 million points inside this model?
Well, sorry, what is this?
3 million points.
3 million points, yes.
Million.
In the paper, in the paper there's a nice table with all the numbers of points. So this so they range from 500,000 to, I think 3 million is the biggest number of points, yeah. And but crucially, we don't actually the point cloud rendering technique doesn't actually render all the points. It basically, in an offline process, dumps that point cloud into an octree, and then traverses that octree in a breadth first fashion and downloads the higher resolution nodes of the octree first, and with the color of the points inside. And that basically means that you are downloading more and more data, increased resolution of the data. I think I cap, for performance purposes, I cap it at 3.3 million points in total for the scene, because beyond that, my poor little MacBook starts to complain. So the total number of points never goes beyond 3.3 million points for all of the different point clouds. So don't forget, we've got several point clouds. We've got from the LiDAR, from the sphere reconstruction, from the Kinect reconstruction, and so on. So.
Another question?
Thank you. We have one more question. Yeah, go ahead.
Looks like really cool work. Have you had any interest in, it seems to me like there's a lot of non-media movie production sort of applications, like forensic reconstructions of crime scenes and fire scenes and all. There's a lot of people sort of interested in that kind of, you know, virtual environments for sort of scientific applications. Have you had any?
That's a very good point. I haven't really thought about it. The reason we've been focusing on the movie side of it for the time being is simply because we have the source data. And I should point out, none of this work would be possible without some fantastic research that's been going on in the University of Surrey, which is to do with the generation of this data. And actually, I'm writing a collaborative paper right now for transactions and multimedia, I think, which will hopefully present both their work on the actual generation of the matrix sheet to position the each of the source data in the unified 3D space, and now our visualization work. Because ultimately, without knowing the positions of each of the camera images or the sensors or whatever it is, then you can't visualize them. You know. So to answer your question, I think there are applications there, but I think getting how do you get that data, and you have to have someone saying, I manually found this bit of evidence that X equals 39 and Z equals 24, whatever it is, you know. And that might be quite costly, we'll see. But if you can go with a handheld laser scanner, I think that's the future as well now. these handheld laser scanners to go around and record a crime scene, that might be interesting.
All right, thank you very much.